It's a musical.
It's also a love story.
I would say that it's really a woman's journey.
The journey.
Journey.
Of a young woman.
I'd say it's about
the Brill Building in the 50s and 60s and this woman's journey.
A journey.
Journey.
Trying to make it as a singer.
Who gets sidetracked from her goals.
The story begins in 1958.
To take this story, and to take the story of a singer-songwriter, a woman.
Writing songs about other people's pain.
But she's not only going through a journey as a woman, as an artist.
I think she's like one of the first female singer-songwriters.
She's also going through a journey of sound and music.
She learns the ropes.
And it wasn't really until she could suffer and have a wealth of experiences.
And through relationships and having children and
pushing past a lot of impediments and barriers
towards finding herself an independence and
following her vision and following her muse.
That she could write her own songs.
You know, she does get to her goal. She just, you know, lives life before she gets there.
Ultimately, a really uplifting movie.
It's a timeless story.
I mean, I had always wanted to do something about this period.
When she first conceived of her whole music program for the film, you know, she had written it from a hotel in Chicago on stationery, handwritten it.
Oh God, I had almost forgotten about it.
And it was handwritten in like 5 or 6 pages.
I remember, I think I was in a hotel in Chicago, as a matter of fact. I was like too impressed for maybe to Loken.
And I was so excited about it. I mean, this handwritten piece of, it was so articulate and it's so exciting that I faxed it to Universal. And that became our music agenda for months. I mean, different executives were walking around with those 4 pieces of paper that were handwritten in Xerox.
From there, it was really funny because I started formulating the ideas and I told Ruth, I said, I should tell you that I'm thinking that I want to do something about the Brill Building, about a female songwriter, but it would span over a decade, so it's a little, you know, ambitious, but that's what I'm thinking that I want to do. Says, okay, she was going to tell Marty, who I could not call Marty then. I referred to him as Mr. Scorsese. I couldn't even, like, you know, make me ill, the thought of even saying his name, because I was in such awe of him, and still am, but I can at least call him Marty now.
Then I met Allison, and Allison, Illeana, and Ruth got together and started talking about, the type of picture they wanted to make. And I'm also extremely interested in films made by women, women directors.
And I just started brainstorming. I was like, you know, I've been thinking that we should honor songwriting in the music, and that we should put songwriters of the period with new songwriters and see what happens there.
She really took sort of a pastiche of a lot of experiences that I think women songwriters went through at that time.
Not only do we all already have someone like you, but we all are trying to get rid of the someones like you we already have.
At the point that we got going on the film, Marty and I basically looked at a bunch of films together, you know, some films that were like musical dramas or musical melodramas, and which was very different from the musicals of, say, Vincent Minnelli and stuff like that, and as what we think of as the MGM musicals. They were a little darker in tone, more adult. Things like Young at Heart was a big one. It has one of the most amazing suicide attempt scenes I've ever seen in a movie. And it's a musical. I mean, it's Doris Day, you know, musical. But it's got a very dark edge to it, and Frank Sinatra plays a dark-edged character, a complicated character. And I especially looked at that for trying to decide how Matt was going to, you know, attempt suicide. So there were, you know, we looked at those movies for a lot of things, you know, for how they got into musical numbers, how men and women collaborated together on music.
Allison and I were big fans of the old melodramas, especially Star is Born, and we very much wanted to make a movie that was in that tradition.
We watched a lot of Cirque movies, actually, in preparation. Because, I mean, in a way, I feel like it is in a very big way, I feel like it's a melodrama in the old great sense of the word.
The dress fits the occasion. It's you who doesn't fit.
But with funny stuff. I mean, there's definitely funny stuff.
Well, if anything, it suffers most from a shoddy arrangement.
So what exactly did you like about my record? The thickness of the vinyl? By the way, I did that shoddy arrangement that you were describing. You're a horse's ass.
Hey.
What did you do to a Cosette?
Nothing. She went nuts on me. I think she wants me.
We both said it's funny that women never really got together and collaborated about the things that they thought were important, which was love versus career, babies, men, married men, etc. And why not, you know, throw that all into a pot and take things from her life, things from my life, and make a movie about it.
From what I know, Allison wanted to write, was fascinated with the girl groups in the Brill Building, and also wanted to incorporate some of her relationships, strained relationships with men, into that that milieu.
The personal stuff is always pretty easy for me because I can work things out and I can also rework them. So I can work through a lot of feelings and then I can turn it into what I wish it had been. You know, I learned that trick real early on when I was a kid, so you know, that part was not so hard. It was a little bit harder shooting personal stuff, you know, I think in some ways. I was like, God, I live this. Why am I shooting it, you know?
I don't need a friend. I mean, I have friends.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd be a wonderful friend, really. It's just that,
yeah, I know.
You know, gosh. I'm sorry, maybe we should go or something.
I love the screenplay. From the first time, I love the treatment. So to think of like those little scraps of paper with the ideas and realize that now that it's all, you know, filled with props and costumes and hair.
The script sort of takes a life on of its own, and Allison's very giving about that. It's like having a kid and you let the kid go to school and they become something different than what you might have planned.
That was great, everybody. That was really good.
I think the really great directors are ones that create a comfortable space for an actor to work in and let something new happen for the first time instead of somebody that says, do that. It's a kind of a much more collaborative vision, and she's wonderful at that.
Something about her stuff, it really has an emotional core. It's kind of special. I think even like the way she shoots things, and everything seems to have a real, really fluid, emotional quality to it that I really respond to. It's really, I think, unique to her in a funny way.
But you don't see that. And what's it going to take for me to get you to see your spark?
Making a picture, that might sound like a picnic. Every picture is not that easy to make, obviously, and it's always a nightmare one way you look at it.
When I look at the film now, it's just so amazing to me that we were able to accomplish even so much more than I had ever foreseen, you know, the film to be. I mean, there's always a level at which you're making a movie, or you're beginning to make a movie, and it gets kind of hilarious because you realize all these people are taking this very seriously and it's something that you just made up. You know, it's always kind of like, there's always a level at which I thought, God, this was just a daydream I was having, and now, you know, there's a crew of 100 people.
You do always, as an actor, get that feeling of like, oh my God, it's real, now I have to really do it. How terrifying. They've spent all this money and they've gotten all these people and we're really doing a movie now.
You know, every film is a collaborative venture. You know, people always say that. That's like the classic beginning of any kind of acceptance speech. But really it's true. There was so much that had to be pulled together from so many different areas.
The thing is that you can have an idea in your head and you can even write the script, but until you've cast it and crewed up, it doesn't become
the specific film that it becomes.
When you look back at it, you know, what were we thinking, that we could actually do it for the amount of money that we had and the amount of time that we had to do it in? It was phenomenal, and really, had not everybody pulled together in the way that they did, we never would have been able to accomplish this film.
It also goes to show you that if you really want to say something, that you're going to find a way to do it with film, if you're really burning with passion to say something.
Well, I write songs in my bedroom, or in the bathtub, or in the fire escape, and...
That won't do, Denise. You're a professional now. I'm going to let you in on a little secret. This is where all the hits are going to be made from now on. Right here. One scene, all happening under one roof. If you have your artist, your songwriters, lead sheets office, recording studio, studio musicians, all in the same building, you can have a new hit record every week.
It was the birth of rock and roll that really had its genesis in that building. So many of the great artists and talents evolved the songs that would stand for us all in the Brill Building.
I wanted to do something about the Brill Building for a really long time. I mean, even when I was in film school, I just always thought, I bet that was such an amazing time with all those young songwriters there, and they were just kids, and what an amazing time that must have been.
That song was flat on the...
Sure, I learned a lot about the Brill Building. It's in New York, which few people really know.
Traveling back there and doing the research, you really got the sense, and once you see the layout of the building, about how it was a hit factory. It really, everything was condensed in the way that, I don't know, maybe we have a studio facility now where there's, you know, places to shoot and places to edit, and everything was all in one place. And you really got the sense of that this was the first time that had happened.
It still exists as a structure.
I had told Allison, actually, when we met, that I worked in the Brill Building. I knew a great deal about it. I know the way the floors used to be square, so that a person could write the music and then run down to where the piano player was and play the music.
It has four walls, as most buildings do.
They would do everything in that building. They would write the songs. They would. The publishers would be there, the lead sheets, you know, the recording studios. It was all under one roof.
Kiddo, come on in.
Sure,
good to
sure.
See you. Fellas, this is the young lady who wrote your next hit.
They'd be looking for a song, say, for a given artist, and they'd go from one cubicle to the next cubicle, and people would pitch their songs, and they'd say, okay, this sounds good, and they had a studio in the place. They'd record the thing right there. They had producers on staff who worked there.
Denise, we need a B-side. What else you got?
B-side? Well, you know, I sort of write for girls, you know, like myself.
We need something up-tempo.
Up-tempo, okay, something good for me. But okay, let's see what I can do.
I mean, the whole Brill Building phenomenon, I think, was built around the idea that, you know, a record company would find an artist and they'd take him in there and it'd be like a department store.
You really could have a hit record out every couple of weeks. It was kind of amazing, you know.
It was just this magical place in the 50s where all the great hits came out of.
I was a little kid trying to get on Bandstand, and everything that came down out of New York City came down through the Brill Building into Dick Clark's American Bandstand and was filtered into America that way.
Of course, it goes way back to the turn of the century, Tin Pan Alley, Gershwin. That building has such history, and for years I wanted to do a picture about what went on in the Brill Building. And you could just take any given period of time and some other great example of popular music and popular culture has come out of 49th Street and Broadway.
The hits are just endless. Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow and Chapel of Love.
Little Richard and Fats Domino.
The Drifters, all the Monkees hits.
Wake Up Little Susie.
Chuck Berry and Elvis Presley.
Up on the Roof.
Last Train to Clarksville.
All of the Goffin King songs.
Simon and Garfunkel.
Anything by Gene Pitney.
Neil Diamond.
Shangri-La's Leader of the Pack.
The Shoop song. Does he love me? I want to know.
He hit me and it felt like a kiss.
Phil Spector and the Wall of Sound.
Hit song from the 50s. He hit me and it felt like a kiss.
Dun, 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 dun. He hit me and it felt like a kiss.
Well, you think I could make that up? That was a hit song.
Be My Baby.
Men treated women a little bit different in the 50s. Boy, I wish it was like that now.
The girl groups, the Ronettes, and the Crystals.
Lieber and Stoller, the great songwriters.
Burt Bacharach, of course.
The Shirelles.
The Everly Brothers.
He's a rebel. It's just phenomenal how many songs came out of there.
I mean, that's considered the golden age of music, okay. Is that late 50s, early 60s. A lot of great stuff came out of that time.
Denise, what do you think?
I think it's a sure hit, Joel. Congratulations. Excuse me.
This woman who jolted us back and said, you know, females, women, they have a point of view. There's this something very interesting, and we need to hear what they have to say.
I think it probably was pretty radical, the fact that women were actually behind the talent, behind the songs that were on the radios.
The late 60s was kind of the genesis of this new thing called the female singer-songwriter. So God give me strength. God give me strength. Men and women, but even women to a larger degree, never had surfaced as far as, you know, people who wrote their own songs completely, all of their own material, and performed the stuff too, and were out there as the front person. Pretty much you were either a singer or a writer.
I bet you have other songs too.
No, I'm planning to record my own songs.
What do you mean? I mean, you're either a singer or a songwriter. Which is it?
I'm both.
Nobody's both. You're either one or the other.
Well, I'm both.
There weren't that many examples, really, of men doing that either. I mean, there were a few, maybe Smokey Robinson, Chuck Berry. You could think of a few others, but for the most part, the same was true of men.
Well, that doesn't change the fact that I can't sell girl singers.
All right, okay, so could you leave then so I could go back to work?
I mean, they're a mess.
The 60s was an amazing time. I mean, probably one of the most revolutionary decades in the century.
It was the mid-60s when things really started tapering off. Well, rock really started to change then, too.
The British invasion really, I think, kind of spelled the end of the Brill Building era, because it was all these self-contained groups who were writing their own material, performing it themselves, coming, and they were taking over. So I think that a lot of people, I mean, this is my hypothesis, that a lot of the artists over here saw that and said, wow, I can do that too, you know.
Because I did the movie, that was really when I most discovered how much that it ended, because groups like the Beatles and groups like the Rolling Stones were writing their own songs, and that's really what ended it, and we tried to touch on that a little bit.
The whole game's changed now, kiddo. Everyone's writing their own material. And now with Betty checked into Lexington and Shasha getting married, that pretty much puts an end to the luminaries. I gave Doris some leads on session work out in Los Angeles.
Have you thought about what you're gonna do?
That period of having a songwriter create something for you was finished, because it was the age of the bands now, you know, who were writing their own songs.
Not many groups really could write songs as well as the songwriters from the Brill Building, but they were made redundant.
Lennon McCartney definitely changed that period, which probably saddened them because they were big Brill Building fans.
The music scene shifted from New York to LA, and, you know, it's like a salmon. Where else do you go?
Well, I was wondering what it was like after the British invasion, all these great songwriters booted out of the Brill Building, all hanging out down at the unemployment line, you know? Must have been a really musical unemployment office.
Well, when I first got to New York, I went in just to see if I could absorb any creativity that would come out of it. I mean, the walls sing in that place. It's just haunted with ghosts.
It's no longer a music building, now it's a film building. We actually ended up mixing the picture in the same building that, you know, all these stories took place.
You know, I worked for most of my time in the Brill Building in New York, from 1984, 85 on to about 2 years ago. And when I mix my films, I live on the East Coast now, and when I in New York, and when I mix my movies, when I do basically the majority of the post-production is done there now. It's always the Brill Building.
Originally, we had this was supposed to take place, the majority of it, in New York City, and, you know, the truth was we just couldn't afford to do it.
Well, the actual Brill Building in New York looks very dissimilar to the Brill Building in the period that we're talking about, which is the late 50s, early 60s. And we tried to get the feeling of it rather than the specificity of it. We just tried to get the aura of the Brill Building. So I think we captured that.
I mean, we've really only begun to scratch the surface here. I mean, I think there could probably be 10 movies about the Brill Building, and I think there probably are a lot of scripts out there. Most people who worked at the Brill Building have a script about it.
Okay, you can play it now. Let's roll it.
We really wanted to get a flavor of that time period, so we decided to go back to some of those songwriters that were writing during that time. But in order to make it feel fresh and new, we wanted to pair them with contemporary songwriters.
We had to put together the teams. We had to find these songwriters, for one thing. Find people to sing those songs and record those songs. And we had to find a producer or producers. I mean, originally, I think we were thinking about different producers for different types of things. When I met Larry Klein, I called my music supervisor afterwards and I said, I was like going off and off about how much I liked him and how much I liked him. She says, so is he producing all the songs now? And I said, well, damn near, yeah. So he has produced all the songs, and it's been really so amazing.
After Mi Vida Loca came out, I heard her on The Morning Becomes Eclectic on KCRW, a local Los Angeles station. And in listening to her talk, I thought, I'd like to get to know this person. I like this person, you know. From the time that we first met, immediately we were just right in sync, you know.
You know, there was instant chemistry. I think at the time we just, you know, Allison came back and said, yeah, he seems great. And, you know, he seems like we had no idea that he was actually going to pull off everything that we, you know, soon foisted upon him in terms of, great, so in 3 weeks, can you have 26 songs? It really was a miracle when we look back on what he needed to do. I mean, every song had to be perfect the first time because we didn't have time to go back and make changes.
Well, I'm producing all of the music for the film and scoring, doing all the underscoring as well. And actually a little bit of acting as well.
Rich, when you get to the kid, you're cutting it off just a little bit.
Stretch it out. Stretch kid out, guys. Huh?
You can just give some water.
Let it really come to a natural ending here, okay?
Why don't you sit down, man?
Okay, okay.
All right.
All right, sweet.
Let's make hit records. Let's start.
Heartbreaking. Allison really kind of chose the hard way to go in that, you know, most films, they just use existing records to connote something that was going on during that time, whereas she kind of took on a very hard job of having new songs written to represent all of the genres and stylistic movement that was going on in music between the late 50s and the late 60s.
I didn't know also how we were going to get the music to sound period enough. I knew that a lot of the young artists that I was interested in were very, very well versed in the period and really had a great affection for the period. And I didn't know if the artist of the period would be able to deliver stuff that sounded like the period, you know? I mean, it was a gamble every step of the way.
The writers who participated in the project tried to write new songs that credibly could sound like the Everly Brothers could have chosen these songs to perform, or Beach Boys could have performed them, or the Platters, the Drifters.
I mean, I had specific things in mind for every single song, and Larry and I would just go through, I would pick like five songs and say, okay, it should sound like this, and then we would tell the songwriters.
And Allison from the beginning would give us tapes, tape after tape. It was like you were dating someone in high school where they make you their favorite tapes with their 12 favorite songs that really mean something to them, and Allison would give you these tapes, and they were fantastic.
The musicians made it seem like it was suddenly a very serious thing that we really had to pay homage to these people that we were suddenly imitating. I mean, when you're doing a kind of a riff of a Beach Boys song, you know, obviously you want to make sure, and I would think, how are they going to, there's just no way. How are they going to be able to do a song that's as good as the Beach Boys? And then every song that would come out of the studio that I would hear, I mean, I couldn't believe it.
Well, I think what really hit it, I mean, you can tell the feelings. You know, when we start humming and singing and moving along with it, you can tell that we have the essence of that period. You hear these songs and you're still humming them, you know, when you go off the set. So that's when you know that you got it.
It's amazing because people would often hear the soundtrack and they'd say, wow, I remember that song, it was great, which is the ultimate testament to what we were trying to do, that it really worked. You know, it felt like some song that you knew was a hit back then. That was the whole problem in approaching this thing. We didn't want to do songs that people already knew because there'd be all those sort of preconceived ideas about it. And it really was amazing how well it worked out.
Now, one of the songs that came in was a song from a young lady named Louise Goffin, who, had sent me some songs. She is the daughter of Carole King and Jerry Goffin. And she had sent me some really great songs that are very folksy and have a kind of Neil Young influence. So I wanted to use something of her. So I wrote that character of Sean Colvin specifically so I could have one of those types of songs. And I figured I could do it in the commune. And that we'd work on a song that would fit with what the character Illeana Douglas is playing is going through at the time. You turn me into a girl.
You left me stranded between two worlds. Between two worlds, which was the thing that Sean Colvin sang. And that had actually been started by Louise Goffin and her father Jerry, who actually was, you know, was there at the Brill Building time. And it was, you know, kind of a thrill to write a song with Jerry Goffin, you know. It's
God Give Me Strength was written by Elvis Costello and Burt Bacharach. Burt Bacharach was just an absolute, a huge influence on my sense of melody and harmony, actually. And my parents used to play Burt Bacharach records constantly in our house. And I'm not sure who actually came up with the idea of teaming him with Elvis. It might have been Karen or Allison, but they actually wrote the entire song over the phone. I believe that Elvis kind of had a start on it, and then he left what he had on Bert's answering machine. Then they started kind of basically working on the song over the phone, but they were never in the same room together while they were writing the song.
When Illeana and I are writing the song Unwanted Number, and we were about to shoot it, I think, and we still didn't have the music, and there was this FedEx package from Elvis Costello with the cassette tape of Elvis saying, 1, 2, 3, 4, and playing the song that I had to learn. There was a little music to it. And it was thrilling. I really felt like I was part of that era where you got a song and you had to lay down the tracks the next day and it counted. There's a local where they mention my shame, whisper my shame. They say he gave her his child, he wouldn't give her his name.
I was enlisted to write what became Born to Love That Boy with Jerry Goffin. And Jerry Goffin was one of my heroes as a songwriter. And so I went over to his house and basically we sat down and I told him, Jerry, we have to sit down and write the ultimate masochistic love song. Dave Stewart of the Eurythmics and Carol Bear Sager wrote a song together, and that's called I Do. It occurs in the film as a wedding song along the lines of going to the chapel. Now it's June and we're gonna get married the day you say that I'm the one. Do you make a promise that we'll always be together? I do. In Another World was written by Los Lobos and Jerry Goffin, and was meant to be representative of the male group area of what was going on in the late 50s, circa the Drifters.
was your girl. How can I reach you when you're living in another world? When you're living in another world. And keep our disguise, stand by our love.
My Secret Love was written by David Berrywall, Leslie Gore, and myself, and was meant to represent Leslie Gore's area of what was going on in the early 60s, somewhat melodramatic love songs. My Secret Love was written to a certain degree by courier and telephone as well, in that Leslie Gore was in New York and David and myself were in LA. Take a Run at the Sun was written by Jay Maskus, Dinosaur Jr. fame. It was meant to be representative somewhat of the Beach Boys' early period.
Joel. Jay Phillips, the one on the guitar. He's the brains behind the band and the wizard behind your next hit.
On their last album, Jay Phillips caught the critics' attention when he added orchestral instruments into their popular surf sound.
Surf and turf stuff. That's not, that's not my thing. It seems this.
Pickle Song was written by Jay Maskus also, and was meant to be representative of the period of Beach Boys stuff in which Brian Wilson was starting to get somewhat esoteric as to the subject matter that he was using as a starting point for his songs. There was actually one song that he wrote called The Vegetable Song.
Well, I'm wondering now we're supposed to do that live.
Where are the cars? Where are the surfboards? It's not the rip ties, man. Come on, I'm not singing that stuff.
Brian, anything to add?
I dig the theremin at the end. It's cool.
He likes the theremin.
I really tried to use a lot of these players who did this work during the 60s, you know, because they know exactly how this stuff was played, and a lot of them are still playing better than ever.
I played on Fats Domino stuff when he came on the West Coast. I played behind the Coasters when they recorded on the West Coast. I played on the early Ricky Nelson stuff. Most of the artists at Capitol Records, which would have included Peggy Lee and Nat Cole, Larry Williams, Boney Maroney, Little Bitty Pretty One, Rockin' Robin. Later on, I played the theme to the Pink Panther for Henry Mancini.
There were a lot of hit records that I didn't realize were hits till way after it happened, with the Spiral Staircase, More Today Than Yesterday, some of the Beach Boy things that I can't remember the names of the song. I was in the studio 6 days a week, three times a day. I might work with Frank Zappa, say, in the night, and maybe the next day work with Frank Sinatra.
One of the very first things I did was about 1964, I did Nancy Sinatra's Boots Were Made for Walking. During that time, I did the Everly Brothers albums, some of them, and I did many things, including Frank Sinatra, Strangers in the Night. I did a few dates with Elvis Presley, TV things like Charlie's Angels, the theme to Barney Miller.
Being a drummer then was a lot different than it is now, due to the advent of electronics.
Well, the drums changed a lot, but the sax didn't change that much.
The drums set the rhythm and everything, but the bass sets the bottom and the heartbeat.
Then, being a drummer was a very busy situation. You have three sets of drums that the cartridge company brings to the date, sets them up for you, so you just go from one studio to another and sit down on a set of drums and attack whatever project you're doing. Then you go to the next one.
The saxophone is, I consider it the voice of the blues band and the jazz band.
You don't play as many notes as a saxophone player or other instruments, but it's the simplicity, the rock bottom of it.
Now it's a lot different. Drums aren't in vogue as far as you listen to movies now, and unless it's a period piece like this one, drums, drums aren't used in an orchestral sense. It's mostly orchestra percussionists. So the rhythm section, when there's a big police chase, you used to always hear the rhythm section going 100 miles an hour. You don't hear that. They do it with synthesizers and different things now.
Some of the music is cycled back, and I'm enjoying some of the solo work that I got to do 20, 25 years ago.
People love bass. You know, that's their, that really get, even though they don't realize they like it. If without it, they would really miss it, you know.
Getting back in the studio and playing what I would have played on a Beach Boys date 20 years ago was interesting, because it was just, you know, a click. You have to just get back there and make sure you're not too technical for the particular track that you wouldn't have been at that particular time, because it didn't fit. So you're playing very basic rock and roll or pop music, and you just have to put yourself in that frame of mind.
So I actually put gut strings back on my bass, so it would sound, that's what I used to use back in those days. And we mic'd it with a mic that I used to use back in those days. There wasn't any pickups or amplifiers or anything like that. And played, tried to get as close to that as we could.
My style hasn't changed that much.
It's actually reassuring on some level to know that music like that could be made still, you know, that all the people that could do it aren't in fact, you know, retired or dead.
My feeling was that we should try and give back music to the period of the Brill Building. We shouldn't just use music of the period. We should actually try and create some new stuff. And the really exciting thing is that that happened. I mean, for people who are Brill Building fanatics and Burt Bacharach fanatics and real collectors of that music, it did exactly that. And in fact, we even ended up with an instant collectible. We didn't mean to, but the first soundtrack release was a collectible because it had the Joni Mitchell version of the song, which was not supposed to be on there. So they were recalled, but people have that, you know, people search now for that copy. So we actually provided an instant collectible as well.
I remember one of the scenes that we were doing where we're very close on the on the couch, and he gets really close to me. It's very sexy, and he's saying,
Can you stay here tonight with me?
And it was so quiet, and you couldn't hear a pin drop. And I heard Allison go off screen, yes! Yes, I'll spend the night with you. And it was that kind of an atmosphere on the set.
To see this guy.
Hi.
Joe Mingala, what are you doing here?
What do you mean, what am I doing here, huh? I'm always here. What are you doing here? Never mind, let me introduce you to a real songwriter. Denise Waverly. Denise, this is Howard Kazan.
Hi.
Hello. Village Phone.
Nice to meet you.
You don't know about the likes of him, and you don't need to.
Why introducing me to him?
I'm introducing him to you. A nobody, to a somebody.
Odd, we had in the script, it was just like a meet scene where you introduce a couple characters and you get on with it.
That is one odd-looking woman. Get any ideas, Kazan? My girl's got too much class for you.
We rehearse on the weekends, and we came up with this idea to dance our way through the scene. And we came up with some really, really stupid dances that were a lot of fun to do.
Kiss me not move. Let loose.
John Turturro's dancing, I think, is a method of birth control. I think it will scare people away from any sexual activity because it's so frightening.
I give credit to Allison for casting a terrific bunch of hams.
I think what they want to know, John, is about the deep and abiding love between us.
Yes.
And how that's the focus of the film.
Yeah. Well, I didn't understand at first, but then after I met Eric and we did a few scenes together, that basically there was no way I could get rid of him the rest of the film.
We did that big dance scene.
We did a scene, and that was it. From that day, I can't get away from him.
Very romantic.
I go to the hotel, he's there. He says, he's always, you know, and now it's become basically a love story between.
Sometimes I'm on this side.
His character and my character. See, I think his character realizes
it's
that.
It's actually an intricate triangle between me, John, and his wig.
And his wig, yes.
Mr. Wighead.
To me, really the movie was about hair.
But basically, this film is basically about a guy with red hair and a guy with no hair. This is not my hair. This is not the way I really talk. I actually talk this way. Actually, I have an English accent. Actually, I'm really Ray Fiennes. One of my favorite accents, and actually, I've worked with Ray Fiennes. I am John, Sir John.
Sometimes John would go off to his room and he'd leave his wig in the room.
And trying to do a scene sometimes with John and the hair.
And his wig would do the scene really well. The wig danced, I think, better than John. Probably can't show that, though. It's a union thing.
And, you know, the wig thing became this whole thing.
I actually became quite close to John's wig. Years later, after the film, John's wig and I had an affair. A brief, doomed romance.
See, Allison, I can't even do an interview alone now.
Come on.
He's here.
Geez, I'm going to have to get you another job just so you leave us alone here.
Chris, how's it been working with some of the different cast members?
They shun me, but, you know, I live with that. That's the way it is. I'm a musician, they shun me. But, you know, I have found things that I could do to kind of endear myself, you know. More coffee? More coffee, Patsy? I have to get going pretty quick here. She wants her coffee, and boy, she doesn't get it right away.
This bell is rung, yeah. She was the lamp that I blessed. She took my last chance of happiness. So God give their strength. God give His strength.